So this video is on cost of capital. Cost of capital. So basically what cost of capital is, this is just the amount of cost that a certain investment will cost an investor. So you calculate your cost of capital, that investment. So there are certain things that are taken into consideration to come up with what they call cost of capital. So first of all, you need to look at your cost of debt. Cost of debt. Cost of equity. Cost of preferred stock. Preferred stock. And of course your cost of debt, cost of equity, cost of preferred stock. You can also have cost of retained earnings, which they say is actually equal to equity. So you can even say like retained, right? Retained earnings, they are like most of the time they yield the same answer, so they say they're somehow equal to each other. So each and every cost here has got a certain formula or a way of how we compute it. Then once you're done, it's like you begin to get you will like come and put them all together, and I'll explain this as we move. So let's start with this one, cost of debt. What is the general formula of calculating cost of debt? So cost of debt is we use this KD is equal to KI 1 minus T. So the KD, what does it stand for? It just simply means this, the same cost of debt, what KD stands for. KI just means cost of debt before tax. The cost of debt before tax. Yeah, that's how you know this is KI. That's the cost of debt before any tax is applied. What about the 1 minus T? The 1 minus T altogether is what they call a tax shield. That's what they call it. Everything in the brackets. Yeah, so tax will be always given. And then now you would substitute in that formula and you get your cost of debt. Next, you have a cost of preferred stock. This one again, this is the formula KP over DP over P. Well, for this one, the DP just stands for dividend. So you get to check in the question, what was the dividend that they were paying? That they were paying for preferred stock. You have to look out for such details. That's when you substitute on the D. Then what about P? P is what? Price. The price of preferred stocks, that's the P, that's what it stands for. Then when you divide, you get your cost of preferred stock, just like that. So you might hear something like, when they were selling off preferred stock, there were some other flotation costs that they incurred. What do you do in that scenario? The formula that you still use is the same. They might have just said that, okay, when they were selling preferred stock, they incurred some flotation costs. So what happens in that scenario, you just come and add a minus F here in the denominator. The P is the price of the preferred stock. You just come and subtract flotation costs, and then you still use the same formula you're seeing on the screen. And then, of course, your D, which is the dividend, and then you proceed just like that. The next cost you look at is cost of equity. Cost of equity. Cost of equity. So this cost of equity, what's the general formula first of all? So cost of equity has a number of formulas, not only one, just depending on the info given. And I'll explain first of all. First of all, you have these two formulas. Let me enumerate the first one. So the first formula that cost of equity uses is this formula from stock valuation, which is what they call capital gains. Yeah, something like that. That's the formula it uses to calculate cost of equity. So as I said, it has got more than one, meaning you can either use this one or yet another formula. So let me just write the other one quickly. Cost of equity can also be equal to risk-free plus beta, open brackets, risk-free, also return on market minus risk-free. This is the other formula. That's one we used to call it the CAPM theory. So it uses two formulas. So just take note. One of them comes from the CAPM theory. The other one comes from stock valuation, which was talking about capital gains. Those are the two which work for calculating cost of equity. So, of course, risk-free. RF stands for risk-free. The B is the beta. They will give you in the question. RM stands for return on the market. Or then RF is risk-free. Everything in the brackets has got what they call a collective name called risk premium. It's a risk premium. Everything there in the brackets. That's another way. So they might just trick you in a question and say the risk premium was so much. Then you'll be like, oh, what do they mean? They just mean everything in the brackets has been computed and has that value there. That's all. Okay. Then the other formula, which was D1 over P0, right? That one. Again, we said depending on the info given in a question. So if you just see the question talking about the next dividend was what, the price of this stock was this, then you know, okay, it's leading me to what, to this formula. So just look at the details, then you know. Then about what about G? G stands for growth rate, the growth rate. So you would see those details, and then you know, okay, definitely I'm working with this formula. D1 is just like, should I say, the dividend at the end of year one. Certain ways that you know that they're talking about D1, they'll be like, okay, the next dividend is this one. Yeah, that's how you know it. Okay, they're talking about D1. They just use some certain words which you just take note that, okay, this is D1. When they say the last dividend that was paid out, most of the time that one will come and become like your new initial, which they call D0. So just take note of certain words they use, and then you know it, okay? I'm sure it's D0, it's D1, but the formula just requires you to have what? D1. If D1 is not given, we compute it like this. D1 is equal to D0, open brackets 1 plus G. That's how we get D1 whenever it's not given directly. Last but not the least, in cost of capital, after you have gotten all your costs, you sum them up, you look out for what? The weights. How do you get these weights? So you might be told that the amount of debt in the company, maybe they will tell you this, 1,000. The amount of equity in this company, sorry, let me just write that well, equity is maybe 2,000. And the amount of what? Preferred stock. Preferred. I'll just be shortening some of these words. Maybe they'll tell you 500. Total investment is like an addition of all these three, which gives you 3,500. Then how do you get weights now? Weights are just simply, you get the category, for example, data, divided into the total investment. What will that give you? Which is like 1,000 divided by 35, which should give you okay, this is just an example. Let me just try and punch that. Okay, 1,000 divided by 35, I'm getting 0.28. You do the same thing for the next one, equity also. 2,000 over 35, you find that it should give you, this one will give you how much? 2,000 divided by 35, 0.57. The last one is 500 again. 500 into what? 3,500. When you divide that as well, it should give you 0.14. Okay, let me just see. I'm just trying to just repunch the one for date again, just to be sure I didn't leave out anything. So the one for dates, okay, 0.2, I think 6. 2.85, but you just round off to two decimals. So usually when you add up your weights, they should add up to what? To one. They never cross one. That's just another rule you need to know about weights. They never cross one. No matter how many entities you have, your weights are always equal to one. So after you've gotten your weights, each form of financing, debt, equity, preferred stock has got its own weight, right? You don't forget about this. Then you go and substitute them in this general formula for calculating the cost of capital, what they call the WACC, the weighted average cost of capital. It's the same meaning as cost of capital. We just shorten it. It's this. This is the general formula. W that and that plus W E and K E plus W P and K P. Something like that. So what did the WD stand for? Weight of debt, just by the letter. KD, cost of debt. So it's like you're multiplying, right? These two, and there's no sign between the two letters showing that you're multiplying. So you're like, you have your weights that were just from calculation. You just be easily substituting, maybe like 0.28 times whatever cost you get. You go to WE, meaning weight of equity. Equity also have its own weight, we're just from calculating it. I think that was like 0.57. You put it there times the extent cost of equity you get. Then weight of preferred stock, same story. It was like 0.14 times whatever cost of preferred stock you get. After that, you add up and you get what? Your weighted average cost of capital. That's all. That's basically a quick summary of how we get the weighted average cost of capital.